So one of our customers messaged us on Instagram earlier on this year, and he was berating his Chinese made combination squares because they kept breaking, and he asked if we could step in. So we don't generally make anything unless it's going to be innovative or better than anything else that's on the market, or ideally both. And so we had to really look at this because most combination squares have been made the same way, in that they are locked into position by a sort of a hook bolt. And that's been the way that they've been made for like over 100 years. And so we thought, well, rather than pull the rule into position and locking it, why don't we try and push it? By doing it that way and pushing the rule, we reduce the stress on any of the parts. You'll see with this is a pretty cheap bog standard combination square. I think this cost me like a fiver, something like that, £5. What's that, $7 or $8? You can see it's quite pitted there. And it's okay, it does a job. I tested to see how square it was, and there was about just over a millimeter out from one end to the other when set at 200 mil. It's about 8 inches. Here's one of Matt's. This is a little one that he uses quite a lot. And it's basic, you can tell it's a lot better. This is by Baco, I think. And so it's made better. The stock is thicker, and you know, it seems like a better made tool. But again, it wasn't very expensive, but it still follows this same design feature, which is that they basically all have this little groove inside the ruler here. And what they do is they have a hook. And if I remove this one, you can see this is the hook that they have. And there's a lot of potential for this to go wrong. It's ever so thin. And over time that could become work hardened, or it'll lose its groove. It's only shallow, that little mechanism there. And this is the thing that breaks, apparently. So what we wanted to do was, rather than using a hook to pull the ruler in, we wanted to use something else that ran along the bottom edge of the rule and pushed it against another edge. And so if you've got two parallel surfaces to parallel edges that are perfectly straight, and you've got a decent ruler that's sandwiched between these two, then in theory that should be nice and square. This is a more and right rule, and we use this quite a lot in the workshop, and we've got several different rulers, and it'd be really handy to just be able to put any kind of ruler in one of these. And so we thought, well, what if you wanted to use an 8-inch rule, or a 300 mil rule, even a meter rule? Could we make a square that you could use all of those rules? And so we've designed one, and we're getting there with it. So far it looks pretty impressive, and we're testing it out at the moment. And so in this video I just wanted to update you and show you what we're doing so far, roughly what it's going to look like. It looks a little bit like a stapler at the moment, so we need to work on that. But generally you'll see how the project is coming along. Right, so what we've done there is Matt's added that bolt there to try and stop the sliding mechanism from lifting up. So what's happening in this current design is we slide the ruler into there, and then this mechanism here has a little recess. I don't know if you can see that. What that does is it grips the ruler and it pushes it up. As imagine my thumb is this mechanism here. It pushes it up and holds it square against that back edge and stops it being moving backwards and forwards. But what we're finding is, as soon as you slacken this off, what this actually wants to do is ride over onto the ruler, and it's not gripping it properly. It's gripping it here rather than in the bit we've designed there. So for the first prototype, we're trying to address the locking mechanism. There's a known weak point. We could just beef this up, but I feel like if we're going to design a combination square, we might as well start with a completely new concept.
We've added a bolt into the back. That bolt is to keep this part inside and stop it from lifting out too much. It seems to be working, but still not enough force.
We'll use a scribe and a piece of aluminium, and this should help us see how square we've got it.
We've basically got this, and there's that little chamfered edge, and on the new version we've also got a little recess there, and that's basically sitting on it, catches the ruler, and it pushes the ruler up to this to make it square.
I am just redesigning this sliding part. Make a couple of tweaks, probably about 10 minutes, and then another 10-15 to make.
The first prototype has several features not currently seen in any combination square. For example, we can use any slimline ruler. It reduces the likelihood of parallax. So if you don't know what parallax is basically where, if you can imagine, it's basically the distance between the marker that you're looking at and then the thing that you're measuring. So if you can imagine being a passenger in a car, looking across at the speedometer, it might look like the driver's doing 70 miles an hour, 75 miles an hour. But if you're the driver, you're looking directly at it, you can see actually in 60, 65. So that's the easiest way to explain it.
And the two-part construction means you can service it easier. So every now and again with a combination square, you're gonna have to check the squareness of it because you're constantly sliding the rule in and out, and that eventually wears the inside of the tool. And so you'll have little wear pads. For example, in this one, you can see, okay, I might have to get the DSLR to focus on this one. Let's have a look. Aha, light, there we go. So you should just be able to make out there were two wear pads and they need to be exactly the same height. If they're not, then your ruler won't sit flat, it won't sit square. So you have to get in there with a file and file them down. With the two-part construction, you should be able to file that down a lot easier and you'll be able to measure it, slip it in, put it, get a square against it, check whether it's square, and then file down another one if you need to. So that's one advantage. We might not go with that.
Where are the earplugs? Are you machining out of that little bit of waste there? Because it doesn't look like there's very much.
Yeah.
There's enough material there?
Yeah.
Okay. We're trying to recycle material because it's very expensive. This piece here, I think, how much was it?
£5-6 to put
that.
Yeah,
so it's about £5-6 for that piece of aluminium. And we need two pieces of that, one piece for the lower, one piece for the upper. And then we're also using it at the moment, just because we've got it, to cut the sliding mechanism out. So ideally when we're machining this properly, we'll have a vise. You don't have to put any of those holes in to save a lot of time.
So at the moment, with the setup of the milling machine, we've got this big fixture plate in the machine, and we use this to attach all of our jigs that we use for production. The downside of that means we don't have any space in the machine for a vise. So when we come in on an evening or a weekend and we work on these prototypes, like we've got this this new tool that we're doing now, it's a bit long-winded sometimes because you have to create a jig for it, even though this doesn't want to be machined on a fixture plate. This will be machined in a vise, but we can't take all of this off to put the vise in and then to machine the stuff and then put this back in again. It just takes way too long. So it's not the ideal setup for prototyping. We do have to sort of interrupt production to do it. Well, one of the things that we're looking at doing is getting another machine, which we're going to put next to this one. And then this one, we're going to change the configuration. So we're going to get rid of this big bed. And we're going to have a quick release system, a pallet changer system on one side, and then we'll have a vise on the other. Because most of our parts are quite small, not perfect at the moment. So it does mean that if you want to make a change or if you want to make a prototype, we've got to clamp the part down any way that we can, and at the moment we're just drilling holes and bolting them whilst we do all the machining. Like I say, it's not ideal, but it does the job for now. So I'm sure some people will see this and they'll say, why aren't you using a vise? Well, that's why. But ideally, yes, we will be using a vise going forward. Right, okay, so it's 8 o'clock at night now. I'm still here at the workshop trying to get my head around this square that we've got here. And so this is the body that we have. So we've got an upper and a lower, And we've got a couple of springs, and we've got the mechanism, the sliding mechanism that sits inside the upper here, like this. And so it's pretty straightforward as far as the components go. And the bits that will wear will be the nut, potentially, and the thumb screw. And so really, in theory, it should last for a long, long time. And just by, well, you can see the weight of this thing, and the fact that the material that we're using, and the fact that this is all CNC machined and anodized, should pair really nicely with your favorite workshop rule too. So we're still working on it, still trying to make some refinements, but I'll keep you posted with any of the updates that we get throughout the week. We're waiting on a new machine vise so that we can try a few different design changes, and we think we're going to modify this so we've got a slightly more substantial thumb screw so we can get a little bit more leverage when we're clamping it down. But yeah, updates to come, so keep an eye out.